32. But you recall the former days when, after you were enlightened, you endured a hard struggling with sufferings, sometimes being publicly exposed to reproach and affliction, and sometimes being partners with those so treated. If you had compassion on those in prison, and you joyfully accepted the plundering of your property, since you knew that you yourselves had a better possession and an abiding one. Therefore, do not throw away your confidence, which has a great reward. For you have need of endurance, so that when you have done the will of God, you may receive what is promised. For yet a little while, and the coming one will come and will not delay. But my righteous one shall live by faith, and if he shrinks back, my soul has no pleasure in him. But we are not of those who shrink back and are destroyed, but of those who have faith and preserve their soul. Now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. For by it the people of old received their commendation. By faith we understand that the universe was created by the word of God, so that what is seen was not made out of things that are visible.
Praise the Lord for his precious word to us.
Last week we had a little look through Hebrews chapter 10, and I had 3 points in my mind. Last week, in relation to Hebrews chapter 10. I only covered two. I spent most of my time on two specific points. The first point was that the Lord Jesus Christ has paved a way. Christ has paved the way for us through his own shed blood into the holy places, that is, heaven, where God the Father is residing. The whole picture in Hebrews is speaking about a high priest in the old tabernacle would shed the blood of the animal in the most holy place, and he would do this seeking the forgiveness of the sins of the people and of the nation of Israel. And the connection here in this passage is that Christ has paid for our sins, for each of us who have genuine faith and belief in him. He's paved the way into the most holy place in heaven by his shed blood. For each of us. That's the connection. That's the correlation. That's what the writer is saying here through the power of and the presence of the Holy Spirit. My second point, which is where all my time went last week, was perseverance. We looked at a passage that says, hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. There was a call to persevere for these Hebrew Christians who were being persecuted. They were being told to hold firm in the faith, walk with Christ until the end. The warning was not to slip back into Judaism, where there was now no further sacrifice for sins, because the fulfillment of the Mosaic law and all of Judaism had come in the Lord Jesus Christ. He was the perfect and complete sacrifice. And so there was an alarming passage really last week, which we looked at, that if you go on willfully sinning, then you've trampled on the Son of God. Technically, you've stepped on Christ. You've profaned the blood of Christ. You've outraged the Holy Spirit. The reality was, if any one of these Hebrews walked away from the faith, there was no further sacrifice for their sins. And this is where we look at apostasy last week. For a recap, apostates are individuals who have great intellectual understanding of the gospel. They've been exposed to it consistently, been part of the people, the congregation, professed faith even, but they did not believe. Faith isn't just about confession of mouth. There must be belief in the Lord Jesus Christ. Belief that he is who he said he is. That he's the Messiah, the Redeemer, the Deliverer, that he is the eternal Son of God, that he is the great I Am, that he alone is the words of eternal life. It's not just about confession or understanding what Christ has done for us. There must be belief, genuine belief. Romans 10:9 tells us, But if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. Genuine faith is both confession and belief. And the falling away of certain individuals here, it showed us who they really were. And some were beginning to fall away at this time in Hebrews because they were neglecting to meet together, as was the habit of some. This falling away was genuine, but it showed where they really were in the faith. 1 John plainly tells us this: they went out from us, but they were never of us. But if they had been of us, they would have continued with us. But they went out that it might become plain that they all are not of us. And so Judas is a classic example of this. He is the number one apostate, essentially, the arch apostate, if you like. He never was saved. He went to the place that was prepared for him. God knows the beginning from the end. We read in Scripture that Christ knew who it was who would believe in him, who it was who would betray him. And Judas, of course, did betray him so that the Scriptures may be fulfilled. Demas, Paul's friend, deserted him, Scripture says, because he was in love with this world. Judas was a definite apostate. Demas may have been, but the reality is only God really knows who he apostate is. And there are individuals scattered throughout Scripture that show the damning signs of apostasy. But of course, backsliding is something very, very different, which is what I touched on last week also. Genuine believers can fall into a backsliding state, but backsliding can be repented of by the grace of God. And I covered all this last week. I covered it so much that I didn't say my third point. And my third point was persecution. 3 points: paved the way, perseverance, persecution. And I just want to touch on this third point very briefly here this evening. If falling away showed that the person never really was of God, never was one of the genuine believers, then perseverance is the sign that they were of them, that they belonged. It's a sign of salvation. The writer says from verse 32 onwards, do you remember when you were first enlightened? When you first understood the gospel? How you came under persecution? When you had these difficult times, when your property was plundered, it was stolen, it was taken, and if it wasn't you who was directly affected, then it was your brothers. But you came alongside them in their struggles, in their troubles, in their difficulties, and you helped them even when they were in prison. You kept your eye on the goal, even when your possessions were taken from you, we read in Scripture. You joyfully accepted that because you knew there was a better possession, an eternal possession waiting for you in glory, which Christ has made full payment for. There was a long-term goal of reaping the true rewards of a Christian. Those rewards are Christ. They are eternal life, and that is the glory of heaven. It all began for the Hebrew believers in persecution, and the persecution continued in the time of this letter, where they were still being persecuted. But the Holy Spirit is saying here, persevere through the persecution. Keep your eyes on the goal, keep your eyes on Christ, and you will receive the everlasting reward of heaven and eternal life, and of course, the Lord Jesus Christ. They were told not to throw away their confidence, to endure until the end. Christ is coming back for the righteous, we read at the end of Hebrews chapter 10. But he's only coming back for those who have faith, genuine faith. That's what makes the righteous righteous. Those who have faith until the end. And so there's a very natural question that comes from this. If Christ is coming back for those in faith, genuine faith in Christ, then what does faith actually look like? What is it? How can we know what it is? And that's what Hebrews chapter 11 is all about. And I realize this was like hatred, they saw it in the distance, but once I come to it, I realize I'm probably going to be hitting a series within a series. So I don't think I'm going to be getting to the end of Hebrews chapter 13 anytime soon, even to the end of Hebrews chapter 11, to be honest. So I'm just going to have to begin to lay a foundation here. This chapter is the hallmark of faith. The heroes of the faith are in here. It's not exhaustive. Everyone is not in here. But there are a whole range of people who are presented in this chapter to show us what faith is, what it looks like, and who have it. And so let's have a little look at what faith is. Verse 1. Faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. But what does that mean? I had a lot of trouble trying to put into words what faith is. It's not quite straightforward. You think being able to, by the grace of God, be able to preach and teach the word of God, you'd be able to say it quite quickly, but I can tell you now it wasn't very easy. I had to spend time with the Lord and ask him to help me to simplify it really. But what is faith? Well, faith to the Christian, in one sense, is like a sixth sense. I mean, it's not tangible within the five senses, I mean. Faith isn't in the physical senses that the Lord has blessed us with, because the flesh profits us nothing. It is the Spirit that gives life. And so faith is like a sixth sense, not a sixth sense as the world would perceive it, in a paranormal sense, but it's being able to see what is unseen. Faith is being able to trust God in everything that he says. We know there are promises in God's word which haven't passed yet. We know that. But faith is this. I trust God. I trust God that everything he said in his word will happen in the future and that it will come to pass. We've got no reason to doubt God, because all that the Lord said would happen right up until this point in time has happened. He promised a nation through a man. And Israel is our testimony. God delivered. He promised a Messiah through a virgin. And he delivered in Christ. He promised that one would rule the throne of Israel forever. And he delivered in the Lord Jesus. The Lord even promised that salvation would come to the Gentiles. And Christ purchased the church through his own shed blood. The Lord delivered. You could stand here all day talking about the promises of God, but the truth is there's no reason to doubt God, because he delivers on his promises. Faith is believing God. Quite simple. Faith is believing God. Not just believing in God, but believing God in all that he said, everything that he's promised. That's faith. Faith is having confidence in God. To be certain that what he said will come to pass. That's the assurance of things hoped for. The assurance. Some translations say the certainty. Be certain of things hoped for. But it's not only that, is it? It's the conviction of things not seen. The evidence of things not seen. And that's the sixth sense. It's not just believing God, but trusting him in the unseen. Now, we can't say that there is no evidence of God. I mean, for me personally, the word of God is evidence of God. The book has stood the test of time. It was 1,500 years of gradual revelation from God. The Word of God is 3,500 years old when we look at the original books of the Old Testament. It stood the test of time. It's the Lord's complete revelation to us. It tells me of the wonderful truths of God, and I wouldn't know these truths if I didn't have the Word of God. It tells me of eyewitnesses' accounts of God. The apostles, eyewitnesses of the Lord Jesus Christ. Eyewitnesses who blatantly said that the Lord Jesus Christ was the creator of all things. They said they witnessed him. They witnessed the miracles of Christ firsthand. They witnessed his life, his death, his resurrection. Peter said, "We don't follow carefully devised myths. We have made known to you the power and the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ." We were eyewitnesses of his majesty. The word of God is not just the infallible word of God, but it bears witness. And it has eyewitness testimonies of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's evidence. These are the apostles who went on to die for this truth. The Christ was the Son of God, that he died and rose again. And the apostles gave their lives to proclaim that truth. The Word of God is evidence of the unseen. We didn't see these things personally, did we? But we have the evidence, and see clearly in faith. I tell you what else is evidence of God. Creation. Ever since the creation of the world and the things that have been made, God's invisible attributes, namely his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived. So the man is without excuse. There's no excuse for man. There's evidence all around us of God. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the sky above proclaims its handiwork. Art sells for millions because of a signature on a corner. But the signature of God is all over our creation. Creation is evidence of God. There's evidence in creation. There's evidence in the Word of God. I pray that there's evidence in each of us. The scripture tells us that without holiness in man, no one will see the Lord. The Lord desires to be seen through each of us through a life that is set apart, that shines into the lives of others. Without faith, we cannot see. Faith is the glasses to see the unseen. It's like when Elisha said to the Lord in relation to his servant, "Lord, let him see." And the veil just dissipated before him, that physical veil. He saw the glory of the host of heaven around him. Without faith, it is impossible to see God. And the Lord knows that. That's why the Apostle Paul said that he was called by grace and that it pleased God to reveal his Son in him. Revelation, a revealing. Acts 16, Lydia had her heart open to the preaching of the gospel. Faith is a gift from God. Ephesians 2:8, for by grace you are saved through faith. It's not of your own doing. It is the gift of God. God gives us a gift, spiritual glasses to see the unseen. Glasses that once you put on, you can't take them back off again. Because once the Lord has revealed himself to you, you can't be unrevealed. You've had a revelation of the Lord Jesus Christ. So faith is belief in God and seeing the evidence of God in the unseen. And so now we really do hit into Hebrews chapter 11. And I don't think it's any surprise that the first point of faith that we are brought into in Hebrews chapter 11 is the creation of the world. The Holy Spirit doesn't take us forward to point out faith. He takes us back to the beginning of time, to the very first physical act of God, which is bringing out time, bringing out creation, the heavens, the earth, the universe, and all that's in there. And straight away in verse 3 we read this. That the creation of God was brought about by the Word of God. Both by the spoken word and through the Lord Jesus Christ himself, who is the Word of God. The Holy Spirit takes us back to a fundamental truth in the faith. That the Lord God spoke this world into existence. And he did it through his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. That's a fundamental truth. By the word of the Lord, the heavens were made. And by the breath of his mouth, all their host. For he spoke and it came to be. He commanded and it stood firm. Scripture tells us that all things were made through Christ. And without him was not anything made that was made. This is a fundamental truth. For the Christian, that God created all things by the breath of his mouth through the Lord Jesus Christ, and it came out of nothing. In eternity past, there was only one God from everlasting to everlasting, the triune God. He alone was there. There was no eternal substance, no eternal material. There was just God. It's called ex nihilo, the postulate, from nothing. God spoke this world into existence. The first 10 words of the Bible. In the beginning, there's time. God created, there's the Creator. The heavens, there's space, and the earth. there's matter. The entirety of creation, in 10 words, it tells you space, time, and matter, and who created all, in just 10 words. The Bible tells you in no uncertain terms, straight away, that God created all things, without need for anything. A material universe came into existence from nothing through God. And it's no surprise to me that the first thing here that we see that the Holy Spirit brings us to examine our faith, to see what faith really is the creation of the universe. Your faith goes back to a fundamental truth, believing God in what he said right from the beginning. It's a firm foundation not only in the earth itself, but in your faith. That's what the Holy Spirit is looking for straight away here. So is it any wonder that the enemy has attacked the biblical account of creation from so many different points, so many different times? Satan is looking to undermine the Christian's belief in a creator God from the very foundation. The reality is this: can you believe God? Did God really say? That's what Satan said in relation to the garden. Did God really say? If you get creation, then your faith has already taken a beating. Because biblical accounts, teaching on sin, atonement, redemption, salvation, the fall, everything is affected. In one sense, last week I preached to your hearts. This week, I'm trying to preach to your minds, which is the importance of biblical doctrine and not moving from it. Foundational. Your faith in relation to creation is attacked regularly. How did creation begin? Wasn't it the Big Bang? Didn't it all come from evolution? Wasn't dinosaurs made millions of years before man? If we genuinely realize these untruths, how they affect the fundamentals of the gospel and God's word, we wouldn't even entertain these theories. It doesn't surprise me that these are being taught in our schools, because if I was going to undermine faith in Christ for generations to come, I'd attack our children in their infancy. I'd teach them untruths in our schools against the Creator God. I present a multitude of religions in order to confuse the people. I'd water down sin. I'd lighten sexual immorality. I'd encourage same-sex relations in order to devalue and undermine the institution of marriage that God has brought in for mankind. I'd blur the lines between male and female, even encouraging our children to choose what they want to be from a young age and to change their minds whenever they want, because God didn't make you male and female from the beginning. You choose. I dumb down hell, saying it's only for the most evil, or that it's temporary, or that it doesn't exist. I reduce Satan to a caricature. I bring access to heaven to everyone, so everyone can go there, most certainly the good. I introduce many ways into heaven, not just through the Lord Jesus Christ alone. I reduce the depravity of man's sin so that no one deserves God's judgment. I flood the people with false teaching and sensuality. I reward cultures with alcoholism and drug abuse. I place the lure of money as the number one thing in society. That's what you target your success on. Money. I drive fundamental terrorism in the hope to affect free speech, and so shut them out of those who faithfully preach the word of God, because without preaching, the people perish. I teach evolution so as to attack the truth of man being made in the image of God. I tell our children that they are nothing more than creatures in the animal kingdom. That we're no different to anything else that is spawned from the cesspit of evolution. This is what I would do to undermine humanity. This is what I would do. Praise God, I'm just a redeemed man by the grace of God. But Satan's been doing this for a long, long time. And we wonder why so many churches are empty when we've been taught from the age of infancy that Christ isn't the only way, or even that God doesn't exist, or that man is just another creature. God did say, let us make man in our image, in our likeness. What a proud to say that man has nothing special about him. I'm not elevating man, I'm teaching, I'm relating to a biblical truth. There is something very special about man, very special about woman, and that is they are made in the very image of God himself, gloriously designed to reflect God, his maker. And so we can all remember when Christ was asked, is it right to pay Caesar taxes? Well, in the lovely trap being set up for the Lord Jesus Christ there, and he responds brilliantly. This is the only time really in scripture, perhaps I wish that the Lord would answer a little bit differently. Wouldn't it be nice if the Lord said, oh, Caesar's order, you need to pay your taxes. Keep your money. But this is what he said, didn't he? Toss me a coin. Whose image is on it? And they responded, well, Caesar's. But render to Caesar what is Caesar's, and render to God what is God's. And we don't get any more than that, do we? But if there was any more enlightenment of what the Lord was really saying here, it would have been something like this. And whose image is on you? Surrender to God what is God's. Give him the glory. And evolution attacks that truth. It says you're nothing more than animals, yet God said, you are made in my image. Christ said once that in the beginning God made them male and female. God put biological boundaries in place. And God designed us and made us in his image. We aren't the product of chance. We aren't the result of millions of years of random selection. Scripture plainly tells us that we the redeemed are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession. That all things are made for the Lord Jesus Christ, through him and for him. That we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works. Evolution is the great lie of the enemy. It denies the handiwork of the Creator. It tells you, you aren't made in his image. And some people claim to be Christian but are willing to accept this direct attack on the very character of God. Because it comes back down to, did God really say? Evolution is alive in the enemy. Don't be fooled. It can't be mixed with creation. And the reality is, the Big Bang is no better either. Because that denies the Creator as well. It denies the moral law giver. We Christians here, we know it. We laugh at the believing in an infinite God who created all things, seen and unseen, before time ever was. All by the power of God's will. God was the cause. Yet the highly intelligent Stephen Hawking said this. He's the great advocate for the Big Bang theory. And when asked what was there before the Big Bang, he said this. There is nothing south of the South Pole. And before the Big Bang, there was nothing. So by that very statement, he believes a material universe came about from nothing. That there was no matter at one point before time. Well, that's ridiculous outside of God. There has to be matter in order to bring about a physical universe if God isn't involved. If there's a physical explanation for the universe outside of God, it has to involve physical matter. In short, there has to be something to make something. And next he was challenged on time. Well, what about time? What was time like before the Big Bang? Well, time's relative, he said. So there wouldn't be time as we now know it. So, okay, now there's no time either. So now there was no matter and no time. And so he was asked, what caused the Big Bang? What kicked off the Big Bang? Because there's always got to be a start. There's got to be a cause. And Stephen Hawking said it was spontaneous creation. It happened without cause. That's not science. That's myth. You can't test it. Our Marcy Stroll had a debate one day with Dr. Carl Sagan, who was an astronomer and an astrophysicist. And Marcy Stroll asked the doctor this question. He said, what caused the Big Bang? What outside influence impacted what is called the singularity to cause it to blow up? And the doctor said, we can't go there, and we don't need to go there. And this is what Marcy Stroll said when he responded. Yes, you do. Because if you think the Big Bang happened gratuitously, that is, on its own, without a cause, then you're not talking about science. You're talking about magic. The Big Bang has been described as an infinite density. An example is, if all of Wales fitted in a little jewellery box, and the little jewellery box popped open on its own accord, and everything that we see now in existence is as it is. All the gravities of law, all the laws of physics, all perfectly in place alongside the entirety of creation. Of course, the Big Bang about all the universe. All that matter, not something the size of Wales, in an infinity or even infinite small space. But scientists can't tell you how the matter got there, where the matter came from, or what caused this infinite density to explode. That's not science. That's an agenda. Science is provable. I love science. As Dev Gordon said, for PGCs. Hope it's science. But science is proven. It's factual. The Big Bang isn't it? It can't be tested. What we really could say in a nutshell, Mr. Hawkins believed this, that there was a moment outside time as we know it, where nothing was there at some point, and something infinite existed. But he denies the creator. Nothing creates nothing, especially with physical matter. There has to be matter to create matter. The only logical reason when matter isn't required is God. That's the only logical reason. The Big Bang is creation mutated to remove God and the moral order, because it removes all accountability from man to God. There was one infinite one in creation. I may be dense, but it wasn't infinite density. It was an infinite God who needed nothing to create what he wanted, where there was no time in eternity past, where time came to be, and he alone could bring it about to be. I'm just trying to speak to your mind here today. You need to hold on to biblical doctrine, because it shows faith in evidence. Through Christ, all things were created, and without him was not anything made that was made. Creation has been cut in all its forms, trying to mutate it into millions of years, billions of years, rather than six literal days. Gap theories that say that dinosaurs were there before man. There's gross errors, so many gross errors in relation to attacks upon creation. I'll give you one basic reason why there were no dinosaurs millions of years before man. And it's in the verse that says, the wages of sin is death. And just as sin and death came into this world through one man, Adam, so righteousness and life came through the Lord Jesus Christ. The point is, there was no sin before Adam. And that means there was no death. And if we say there was death before man and woman, before Adam and Eve, then we attack God's truth on sin. Every attack on creation is a direct attack on God and his truth. It's to call God a liar and to undermine our trust in him. If death was before sin, and we believe it, then why did Christ come? What did Christ redeem us from if death isn't the result of sin? What does his atonement mean if sin isn't the cause? How can Christ conquer death if it was there before Adam? Christ is really saving us from nothing. We can't trust God's word because we deny numerous aspects of creation. Every attack on creation is calculated by the enemy to attack the reliability of God. In doing so, he attacks the origins of sin, the redemptive work of Christ, the atoning work of Christ. The reality is, this is the truth, it even nullifies the cross. Dinosaurs are and were part of God's creation, just as man was, it would be made in the fifth and sixth day alongside man. Then we come to the next account, which is, but they weren't literal days, really. I mean, a day is 1,000 years into the Lord, and 1,000 years is into a day. Well, that passage speaks of God being outside of time. It has no relevance and connection in relation to creation. The Hebrew word for day is yom. And by and large, it does mean day. It can be moments when it means a longer period of time, however, no things. But Genesis tells us that at the end of the first day, where the light is called day, and the darkness is called night, there was evening and morning. That was the first day. And what of the second day? Well, there was evening and morning, and that was the second day. What of the third day? Well, there was evening and morning, and that was the third day. So there's a bit of a pattern coming here in relation to Genesis. And then day four actually explains what happens in relation to the evening and the morning. What happens on day four? Well, the Lord actually made a greater light to rule the day, and he made a lesser light alongside the stars to rule the night. So it's night and day. We get a pattern of day and night as we know it. This is why the traditional and still widely popular understanding of the day amongst Christians is a literal six-day creation. All of creation has been attacked. And in doing so, the enemy has a plan for every attack he makes. He's denying the truth of God. Did God really say, did he mean what he said? The Bible tells us plainly that God himself created the heavens and the earth. Not a godless big bang. He did it without matter. That God himself made man in his image. It's not a godless evolution. That all beasts and animals, birds and fish were made within 6 literal days, not millions of years before Adam. But death could have been before sin ever was. The reality is, the enemy is a fool. He's sifting us in our faith in God. And he's looking to weaken our trust in the Lord. And so it's no surprise to me that the Holy Spirit, when speaking of faith, he doesn't take us forward to all the wonderful things that are coming in the Lord Jesus Christ, to all the hope that we have. He takes us back to show us step one, the faith in believing God, right back at the foundation of the earth. Faith stands firm on the account of creation. It's the very first point that the Holy Spirit brings us to. And you're going to look at this in the week that I come to series within a series. And you're going to get trouble. We've got the heroes of the faith to come, and there's a lot of them. I suppose, why rush through them when there's so many heroes of the faith to see? But tonight we'll see it. But now let's bow our heads and pray.